Well, good morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to everyone here in church and to you in the church hall and to those joining us from home. I'm sorry to start our service today with some sad news, which is that John Mayle died last Sunday. So that I know we'd all keep Beryl and the family and friends in our prayers this week. So at times like this that we do what we always do, which is turn to God in worship. And so we're going to worship God now in a hymn, O Worship the King, All Glorious Above. And we'll worship here in church and in the hall in our minds. Those of you at home, worship the Lord with your voices. It'll encourage the neighbours. So let's sing. Shall we stand? So do please be seated as Tom comes to introduce our theme. And also, Tom, you're going to say a word to us about mentoring, aren't
yes.
you?
Yes. Good morning. I've got a little bit of a quiz for you. I've got four questions, and we've got four blocks in the church. Also, for those of you watching at home, hopefully in the comment section, there's going to be a little question being posted for you. So you've got a question as well. They're fairly easy. They get harder as we go along. So do you think, who's the brainiest side, this side or this side? I'm going to say this is the brainiest side then. They're looking quite confident. So if that's all right, this side, you get the nice easy questions. So this side, could someone tell me, what is the name of the current Prime Minister? Boris Johnson. Or if you're being really clever, it's like Alexander de Pechel. Boris Johnson, I think. But we'll go for Boris Johnson. So it's not a trick question. On this side, in the middle section, what was the name of our previous Prime Minister before Boris Johnson?
Theresa May.
Theresa May. That was very confident. I expect you could hear that on the feed at home as well. That was definitely Theresa May. Now, the slightly harder question for this section here. Can anyone remember in the 2017 election what she said the naughtiest thing was that she had ever done? Wheatfields, running through the fields of wheat. That's what she said was the naughtiest thing. And finally, a question which might not seem relevant to all the other questions, but hopefully in a moment you'll see it is relevant. A question for this side over here. Oh yeah, there's a remake of what that may or may not have looked like of Theresa May running through the fields of wheat. Finally, a question for this side. You just like the picture, don't you? So a question for this side. Supposing you leave church this morning and you see a sheep that's in distress, what would you do? This is a bit of a harder question. If you saw a sheep that was in distress, what would you do? So I'm going to give you two answers. Answer number one is to say that you're going to help the sheep. Maybe you're going to get it some support or phone the RSPCSA or something along those lines. Option number two is, and I'm going to go over here because my microphone's gone crackly, but I can still see you. Option number two is you say, it's a Sunday, I'm not going to do any help at all. I'm just going to walk on by and leave the sheep there because it's a Sunday. It's the day we go to church. I'm not helping the sheep. So what are you going to go for? Let's see this side. Are you going to help the sheep? But what about the fact it's a Sunday? Are you not going to say, let's respect the Sunday and leave the sheep to it? Of course, you're going to help the sheep. And technically, because that was an opinion, there was no right or wrong answer, but you might well have lost some friends if you said you'd just leave the sheep to it, wouldn't you? So why are those questions relevant to what Rob's going to talk to us about today as we continue our series on the book of Matthew? Well, Theresa May said that the naughtiest thing she'd ever done was to run through the fields of wheat. And in the story of the Bible that we're hearing today, we're finding out about a time when Jesus and his friends went through the fields of grain. And the thing that they did was seen by the Pharisees not just as being naughty, but as being downright not okay, breaking the law in their view. Because they went, they saw some grain, they were hungry, they picked the grain, which was okay to do normally, but this was the Sabbath. And they said that picking the grain was working. The Pharisees were not at all happy. And then to make things even worse in the Pharisees' books, even worse, Jesus and his disciples went and they healed somebody who was unwell. And then Jesus was trying to explain why mercy was so much more important than just following the law, why it was important to have mercy on those people. In a minute, I'm hoping some of the folks at home might have an idea of what mercy is all about. I'll do it in 2 seconds. But Jesus used a story about a sheep. He said, if there was a sheep in distress, should you leave it on the Sabbath or should you offer it help? And I like the fact that we've said it as a church here. If we go and see a sheep outside who's in distress, we would, of course, go and help it. So let's see what mercy is. So I've just got, this is some of the stuff that people have been giving in from home. Oh, wow, we've got loads of comments. Well done, everyone at home. We've got gracious and forgiveness, forgiving someone who doesn't deserve to be forgiven. So we see a lot about mercy. It's not something that someone's necessarily entitled to, but it's something that's voluntarily given to them. Forgiveness through the death of Jesus. Brilliant. Some really, really good answers there. So mercy isn't something that people earn, but it's a gift that can be given, a gift that we can be given from God, a gift that Jesus gave to people, and a gift that we can also pass on to others by showing them mercy. So that's a very brief introduction to what we're doing. Because I'm going to be out with the Seekers, and we're going to be looking at forgiveness today, so very, very closely connected to mercy, I've got my notes here, so I'm going to get that in a bit early, if that's okay with everybody. Just to let you know, we have a mentoring training day coming up in Trowbridge. It's being organised by Youth for Christ. So anyone who knows YFC, Youth for Christ, will know that they are really, really good. So any training that they do is well worth going to. This mentoring training day is taking place on the 10th of October. There's no charge, but donations are welcome. And it's particularly geared towards those working with secondary school age children. But it would kind of be relevant to all ages, but particularly focused on working with secondary school children in school. This could lead to many things. If you wanted to become a volunteer with YFC, that's the training they need you to do, but there's no obligation. It's just about giving people the skills. It would also help if you're going to do some mentoring or supporting young people in a church setting. Or it might just be something that you think this could be helpful for various other bits of your church work and your church ministry. If you're interested, do have a chat to me, and I'll put you in contact with Dan, who's organising the course. And you've got all the details were just up on the screen there. So you've got the details of the mentoring training day in Trowbridge on the 10th of October. Thanks, Rob.
Thank you, Tom. Now we're going to confess our sins to God now and ask for his forgiveness. And we'll say together the prayer of confession, which will come on the screen. So let's be silent for a moment. And let's pray together. God of mercy, we acknowledge that we are all sinners. We turn from the wrong that we have thought and said and done, and are mindful of all that we have failed to do. For the sake of Jesus, who died for us. Forgive us for all that is past, and help us to live each day in the light of Christ our Lord. Amen. May Almighty God, who sent his Son into the world to save sinners, bring you his pardon and his peace, now and forever. Amen. Now, traditionally in our morning prayer services, we've had a look at a psalm, and we're going to have a look at a few verses from Psalm 105 this morning, and they're going to appear on the screen. And here they are. The psalm, as in all the psalms, teaches us how to worship. And these three or four verses here show us how worship is in two dimensions. Worship is upwards towards God, but it also has a dimension of being outwards towards one another and to the world. So you've got two directions, up and out. Look at verse 1. Thank the Lord, call on him, and make known his deeds. Up and out. Sing praise to him and tell of his deeds. Glory in his name, and let the people's hearts rejoice. The message is, if we look to the Lord, it affects how we relate to everything else. And that's our worship. So what we're going to do is we'll say these words together in unison. And then after that, the Gloria will pop up on the screen. And we'll finish by saying that together. So, give thanks to the Lord. Call on his name. Make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praise to him, tell of his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength, and seek his face always. Glory, glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. And I'm going to invite Dorothy to come and read our first lesson.
Our first reading is from Hosea. Chapter 6, starting at verse 4. What can I do to you, Ephraim? What can I do to you, Judah? Your love is like the morning mist, like the early dew that disappears. Therefore, I cut you in pieces with my prophets. I killed you with the words of my mouth. My judgments flashed like lightning upon you. For I desire mercy, not sacrifice, and acknowledgement of God rather than burnt offerings. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Dorothy. Now we're going to sing again. We're going to sing what I think is a reassuringly honest hymn, which is, for that reason, full of comfort. Verse 4 of this hymn says this: Be our strength in hours of weakness. In our wanderings, be our guide. Through endeavor, failure, danger, Father, be thou at our side. Let's stand to sing. Father, hear the prayer we offer.
Thank you.
Do please be seated. And now Richard is going to come and read our second lesson. Thank you, Richard.
Our second reading for today is Matthew 12, 1 to 14. At the time Jesus went through the cornfields on the Sabbath, his disciples were hungry and began to pick some ears of corn and eat them. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to him, "Look, your disciples are doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath." He answered, "Haven't you read what David did when he and his companions were hungry? He entered the house of God, and he and his companions ate the consecrated bread, which was not lawful for them to do, but only for the priests. Or haven't you read in the law that on the Sabbath the priests in the temple desecrated the day and yet are innocent? I tell you that one greater than the temple is here, and if you had known that these words mean, 'I desire mercy, not sacrifice,' you would not have condemned the innocent, for the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath. Go on from that place." And he went into their synagogue. And a man with a shriveled hand was there. Looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, they asked him, "Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath?" He said to them, "If any of you has a sheep and it falls into a pit on the Sabbath, will you not take hold of it and lift it out? How much more valuable is a man than a sheep? Therefore, is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath?" Then he said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." So he stretched it out, and it was completely restored, just as sound as the other. But the Pharisees went out and plotted how they might kill Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Richard. Shall we have a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, thank you for your word that we've heard read. We pray now that by your Spirit you'd help us to understand it, understanding to believe it, and believing to obey it for the glory of Jesus our Saviour. Amen. Well, we're going to be looking at that second reading, part of our journey through Matthew, got as far as Matthew chapter 12 now. And I wonder if I were to ask you this question, what you'd say. Would you say that you are a religious person? It's probably one of those questions that needs a little bit of thought before answering, isn't it? I guess we've all come across those kinds of religious people who make you feel that you certainly wouldn't want to have very much to do with their kind of religion. For instance, religious people arguing their case and expressing themselves in a hostile and aggressive kind of way, which is quite repulsive. Religious people whose objective seems to be only to win the argument or to beat the other person into confessing their foolish errors. But then we've also come across religious people who are kind and gentle, and you warm to them, and you're inclined to want to listen. So there are religious people, and there are religious people, aren't there? And Jesus had a lot of trouble with the first kind. These included the Pharisees, an influential religious group. And they show up in verses 1 and 2 of our reading. At that time, Jesus went through the cornfields on the Sabbath. His disciples were hungry and began to pick some ears of corn and to eat them. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to him, "Look, your disciples are doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath." Now, Scripture taught God's people to keep the Sabbath holy. We all know that. It's the fourth commandment, isn't it? Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. And the reason given is that God himself rested on the seventh day, so his people are to do likewise. It's meant to be a day of rest, a holy day for rest. It was a merciful gift of God to his people, a gift of a way of living that honoured him and benefited them. But the Pharisees had developed that healthy principle into a burdensome list of all the things you can and can't do on that day, mostly things you can't do. So this is an opportunity for them to accuse Jesus about what his disciples are doing, and to say that picking an ear of corn on the Sabbath is the same, in essence, as reaping the field. And then eating it as well, well, that's the same as preparing a meal on the Sabbath, isn't it? There, they say, look at all these ways in which they're breaking God's law. Now, it so happens that they're wrong about that, because, in fact, the Old Testament law specifically allowed people to pick and eat the corn in their neighbor's field. It comes in Deuteronomy chapter 23. If you enter your neighbor's cornfield, you may pick the ears with your hands, but you must not put a sickle to his standing corn. In other words, go ahead, just pick and eat. Just don't do it with a combine harvester. This was a merciful provision of God for the poor people. So the Pharisees are wrong about that. But the way Jesus decides to respond is to remind them of two incidents from what we call the Old Testament scriptures. First of all, he says to them, verse 3, haven't you read what David did when he and his companions were hungry? He entered the house of God, and he and his companions ate the consecrated bread, which was not lawful for them to do, but only for the priests. This is the occasion when King David went into the tabernacle. It comes in 1 Samuel 21. Now, in those days, the tabernacle was the holy place where God used to make his presence known, a very sacred place. Well, David, faced with the hunger of himself and his men, took the consecrated bread that had been set out in the holy place as a thank offering to God, and they ate it. Was this allowed? Well, no, but this is Jesus' point, that as far as God is concerned, the law matters, but mercy comes first. There's no blame for David in providing food for hungry men. And then Jesus follows on, verse 5, and haven't you read in the law that on the Sabbath the priests in the temple desecrate the day and yet are innocent? Now, what does that mean? Well, the Pharisees would have understood it. Those Pharisees who made such a big deal about keeping the Sabbath day holy. Well then, you Pharisees, it's as if Jesus is saying, well then, you Pharisees, just have a think. Have a think about what goes on in the temple every Sabbath day. God specifically commands, this comes in Numbers chapter 28, God specifically commands that the priests on the Sabbath in the temple should sacrifice two lambs. And what's that if it isn't work then, eh? Jesus' point is that this work is a sign of mercy, because the death of those lambs was to take away the sin of the people. And in that way, they point forward to an infinitely greater sign of God's mercy. And you Pharisees, do you know what that is? Verse 6, I tell you that one greater than the temple is here. Here I am, standing before you. Verse 7, if you had known what these words mean, I desire mercy, not sacrifice, Remember, we heard that in our first reading, didn't we, from Hosea chapter 6. If you had known what these words mean, I desire mercy, not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the innocent. For the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath. See, the bread in the tabernacle, the sacrificed lambs in the temple, in each case, the point is the same, that as far as God is concerned, the law matters, but mercy comes first. Jesus doesn't set aside the Sabbath law or any of God's laws, but the Son of God has the right to interpret them, and when he does, the order is always the same. The law matters, but mercy matters first. Verse 9. Going on from that place, he went to their synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. Looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, they asked him, "Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath?" See, despite all this, it seems the Pharisees are still no further forward. They look at a man with a shriveled hand, and what do they see? Not a man who needs healing, but an opportunity to set Jesus up as a breaker of the laws that are to do with the Sabbath. And once again, Jesus takes them head on to show up where their thinking is all wrong. You see, the Pharisees' religious rules allowed medical help to be given on the Sabbath, but only if the person's life was in danger. Well, this man wasn't about to die from a shriveled hand. So there's the setup. Their attitude is heartless, and that's where Jesus zeroes in. Verse 11. He said to them, "If any of you has a sheep and it falls into a pit on the Sabbath, will you not take hold of it and lift it out? How much more valuable is a man than a sheep? Therefore, it is lawful to do good on the Sabbath. You Pharisees allow the rescue of a sheep on the Sabbath day, but not the rescue of a human being." Verse 13. Then he said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." So he stretched it out, and it was completely restored, just as sound as the other. But the Pharisees went out and plotted how they might kill Jesus. See, the law matters, but mercy comes first. And here's a big difference, you see, between these religious people and Jesus. The Pharisees' way of seeking to honor the Sabbath is to do nothing and to force everybody else to do nothing. But Jesus' way of seeking to honor the Sabbath is to do good. It's clear that a major clash is brewing. It's becoming inevitable. And for the first time, we're told that they start plotting how to kill him. They can't cope with the one who so resolutely insists that the law matters, but that he is Lord of the Sabbath, and that mercy comes first. So what about us, you and me? Let's be religious people. But let's be the right kind of religious people. Jesus's kind. The sort who honor God by seeking to keep his laws, but with hearts that understand that when the occasion arises, we follow the order modeled by Jesus, that mercy comes first. Amen. Well, we come now to our creed, that time when we affirm our faith by saying the words together. So let's stand, and the words will be on the screen. And we say together, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. We believe in God the Father, who created all things. For by his will they were created and have their being. We believe in God the Son, who was slain. For with his blood he purchased us for God, from every tribe and language, from every people and nation. We believe in God, the Holy Spirit. The Spirit and the Bride say, come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Amen. And may Almighty God strengthen that faith in each one of us. Let's sit now, because I'm going to ask Sue to come and lead us all in prayer, both us here in church and in the hall, and also you folk at home. Sue.
Let's have a moment of quiet as we come before the presence of Almighty God. With the psalmist, we say from Psalm 100, verse 4, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. So this morning we come to you, Lord, to give you thanks and to bless your name abundantly. We thank you for your continued mercies to us and for your great faithfulness to us, which are new every morning. We thank you that we could wake up this morning with joy in our hearts, and we had the liberty to come into your house to worship you, to gather together into your name, and to hear your word. So this morning, Lord, we lift up your church to you today, for it is your church, Lord. And we pray that your church will grow in strength and power in every country of the world. But we pray for more, Lord. We pray for revival. Not just revival in the church, Lord, but let it start, Lord, with revival in our own hearts. Lord, let us be not a people without power, but people that rise up in truth in the power of the resurrected Christ. Lord, you have formed us to be salt and light. Let us not ignore this calling. We also pray for our brothers and sisters in the persecuted church, and we especially lift up the church in Iran today, a church that, in spite of death threats and persecution, a church that's growing, Lord, and so we ask that you will be especially close today to our brothers and sisters in Iran. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we bring to you any people that we know that are going through the pain of bereavement, that are lost and in terrible pain and trauma at the loss of loved ones. We especially bring to you today the family and friends of John Mayall, asking that your presence will be very close to them at this very sad time in their life. We thank you for his life and for his testimony, Lord. Psalm 41, verse 1 states, blessed is the one who considers the poor. In the day of trouble, the Lord delivers him. So today, Lord, we ask you to consider the poor. We bring to you those who are disadvantaged, that struggle to eat or find water on a daily basis, especially with the added burden of COVID. Lord, you came to this earth to give honor to the least, the forgotten, and the overlooked and misjudged. You came to lift up the lost, the abandoned, and the destitute. Give us the grace as your children to do the same. And Lord, we ask that we will always put mercy first. We pray against the strongholds of evil, the terrorist organizations of Boko Haram and Al-Qaeda, who are wreaking havoc amongst the people of Nigeria and Yemen. We pray for the villages in those regions where families have lost their loved ones because of these organizations and other organizations of evil. We pray that those organizations will be demobilized. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we bring to you this morning all those who are unwell, either at home or in hospital this morning. And as the man stretched out his shriveled hand to be healed, Lord, we stretch out towards you, Father, that part of our body, mind, or spirit that is hurt and wounded today. Heal us, Lord, and renew us for your glory. And as COVID-19 still affects our lives, Lord, we do pray, yes, for a vaccine. But we pray that you will remove this pestilence from our world, that you will have mercy on us, Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring the work of the Scripture Union to you today, Lord. We ask that even though they cannot go into schools, that there will be a Christian presence from their literature. And we especially pray for the work in the South Sudan that the Scripture Union is doing. We bring Katie Jackson and her family. Lord, we just ask you will bless them abundantly. Give Katie the strength as she ministers in your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. And we remember today the Battle of Britain. Lord, we give thanks once more for the liberty which the Battle of Britain preserved for us and the world. We remember with gratitude the dedication and heroism of the pilots who took to the skies bravely with the full knowledge that they may not return. We remember their successors now engaged in many parts of the world and pray that you would watch over them. And we bring to you the current Royal Air Force, praying that its power and skill may always be used to safeguard justice, mercy, and peace. And Lord, help us to dedicate that liberty that was won on that day for good and not for evil, and for the peace of all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And now we say the collect for the 15th Sunday after Trinity. Lord God, defend your church from all false teaching, and give to your people knowledge of your truth, that we may enjoy eternal life in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Sue. Now we're going to end our prayers with the Lord's Prayer, and those of you who were with us last week will remember Holly's film, which taught us some of the important words in the Lord's Prayer in Makaton. So those of us who wish to do so can watch her doing that again now as we say the Lord's Prayer together. And if we do, then I'm hoping gradually over a few weeks we'll pick up at least some of the key words and feel able to use them, and thus make St. James's a more welcoming place to people who find that helpful. So let's pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Well, now we come to our family news. There's nothing else, Michael, is there, that's been sent in? Ah, very good. Here we are. Jackie says, thank you for the prayers for Lex, who is recovering from COVID. Thank the Lord for his grace. And Roy and Betty, Dillis, and a number of others there as well. I'm glad Dillis spotted the flowers. I was wondering if anyone would, at home, notice that the flowers are different this week. We're in our autumn colours, so thank you very much to the little team, Jill and Jean, particularly, who did those for us. I hope everyone picked up a copy of the newsletter, a new newsletter this week. You'll see that at 2 o'clock this afternoon, the Battle of Britain service is accessible on the internet. You can access it through the church front page, where there's a button to click at 2 o'clock this afternoon. And at 4:30 this afternoon, we have our tea time service, which is a special one for marking Katie's departure and thanking Katie for all she's done. So that's 4:30 in here this afternoon. Now, that service is also going to be streamed. So I know one or two would like to access it in the hall, and that's possible. Also, you can log in from home. And again, is that accessible from the front page, Michael? It is, Tom, is it? Yeah. Next Sunday, we have our morning service at 10:45. You'll also see, I hope you spotted on the way in, we have a new edition of What's News available, which is full of pictures and celebration of all we've been up to recently. So do take those and give them away. We're going to have the rectory home group is planning to meet a week tomorrow, Monday the 28th, at 7:45 in the church. It's clear now, we've received specific guidance from the bishops that home groups may take place. The rules are different if they're in someone's home. They're different there. The rule of six does apply there, but it doesn't apply if we meet in a church building, so here or in the hall. So that's what we're going to do a week tomorrow. At the end of this service, we're going to have a short gap for people to escape, and the rest of us are going to stay behind for what I hope will be just half an hour for our annual meeting. Now, the annual meeting is not going to be streamed, so folk in the hall, if you would like to join in the annual meeting, do take the opportunity just after the service to walk across and join us here. And what I suggest, folks, those who are staying, is that we return to the seats where we've been sitting now, so that any gaps we can know that they're available for the those in the hall to come and join us and sit there safely. So we come then to our final hymn. It's a wonderful hymn, What Grace Is Mine. Let's stand to sing.
is mine, that he who dwells in endless light, called through the night to find my distant soul, and from his scars poured mercy that would plead for me, that I might live and in his name be known. So I will go wherever he is calling me.
Now, the love of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself. The power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service. The joy of the Lord Jesus fill your hearts. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.